The Senior Odyssey, first and foremost, is a research project that's geared toward understanding whether an engaged lifestyle actually improves mental abilities as we get older. So we recruit people from the community who are not terribly engaged, who have activities, you know, less than 15 hours of scheduled activities a week. We try to get the couch potatoes into the lab, and then we randomly assign them to the Senior Odyssey program or to a waitlist control. And we measure their cognitive abilities in a number of ways. We measure speed of processing, working memory capacity, inductive reasoning. And we measure that at the beginning of the program, and then they go through the program. It takes about 5 or 6 months, and then we measure these things afterward, and we find out if there's differential change in the control group and the Senior Odyssey group. And so right now we have two different versions of the Odyssey. We have the Troy program that's built on an existing program called Odyssey of the Mind. It's been around for like 25 years for kids and younger adults. And this was developed originally by an engineering professor in New Jersey who was trying to develop a program to give his students practice with using what they learned in the classroom outside of the classroom, so applying what they learned in real life problem situations. So there are basically two aspects of this program. One, you practice working as a team to develop a solution to a problem that's very challenging. So it requires thinking through a solution, testing your solution, and then revising it based on what you find. And then the other aspect is thinking quickly on your feet. So that's the Troy program that we've adopted for the Senior Odyssey program. And then the spontaneous problems are presented to the teams in groups every week. And so we have these all on PowerPoint slides, and the teams have to work quickly to do that. And so far we've had three Senior Odyssey tournaments in the community. The first one was at a community center, the second was at an elementary school, and last year it was the Carl Foundation on a big stage, and it was really quite an event. So we have grandchildren coming to watch, grandchildren coming to watch their grandparents solve these problems and perform. The Odyssey participants, they work on the problem itself, and they also present this with style. So they make costumes, they create sets, they create a humorous performance, and they perform. And in 8 minutes, they are presenting these solutions. And along the way to developing these solutions, they're exercising a variety of cognitive abilities. They're exercising spatial ability in trying to figure out how to sew up costumes or create sets. They're exercising different aspects of memory in writing and memorizing a script. They're having to exercise speed of processing because there's a lot of give and take in these spontaneous problems. They're exercising all these abilities over the long term. Okay. And the tournament is really the motivator for this, because you know you're going to have to present publicly what you've worked on. And it's really an event. It's a celebration. The teams are formed in the fall based on their preference for a particular type of long-term problem. And they work all year as a team to develop these solutions to the long-term problem and to practice working as a team for problems they've never encountered before. And then they participate in this tournament that's a public event. It's a party. It's a celebration. And they do that in the spring. And they get prizes. So we have trophies, and it's a great day. This is a lot of fun, but there's also some science behind it. There's a lot of literature on cognitive training that seems to show that there's a lot of plasticity in cognitive ability. That is, we have the capacity for change, but it's very specific to the experience. So if you're trained in speed of processing, you get faster, but it doesn't necessarily mean that it improves memory. Or if you're trained in memory strategies, it doesn't mean that you get better at spatial ability. So it seems that the cognitive system is built to respond very specifically to experience. But when you look at the correlational literature, where we just look at about how people live their lives and their relationship to cognition, it seems like that more engaged people, more people that are more active, people that go to museums, people that read a lot, people that take courses at local universities, those people tend to do better in a variety of cognitive tasks. So the question is, how, you know, why is it that these people are, that there's this kind of broad-based vitality that seems to be, that seems to bleed through all of life, you know? So we're interested in how we can be how can we be those people that are good at everything, who seem to be just more mentally vital in a variety of different ways. So what are the principles that lead one to do that? How do we go from a system that seems to be built to respond to experience very narrowly to someone who can function well in a variety of domains in life? And so we're trying to do, so one idea is that an engaged person could be somebody who just creates a lifestyle where he or she is practicing different sorts of activities all the time, different sorts of skills. Another possibility is that an engaged lifestyle requires a lot of executive control, because in managing all of these things, you've got to be planful, you've got to be mindful about managing time and making choices and so forth. And so given that the literature on engagement is really correlational, so we don't really know what's causing what. we just know that these people that are more active score better on cognitive tests. So it could be just that people that are more cognitively vital select out that kind of a lifestyle. And so we're going to do the experiment to see if engagement really does affect cognition. We're trying to do the experiment to assess the causality. So we won't really know if it's the exercise of particular abilities, because we're trying to make sure they get exercise in a lot of different facets, or if it's the executive control, but participants are keeping diaries and so forth, and so we'll have some idea, first of all, if there's a causal relationship, and then from the diaries, some idea about what kinds of things people do when they're the ones that are showing better change. More positive change over the long haul. We have conducted a 2-year pilot that we've finished, and this is going to be, the results from this are going to be published next month. And I have to say, first off, the effects are very, very small, but relative to a control group that just waited to participate the next year, the Odyssey participants showed improvement in speed of processing, inductive reasoning, and divergent thinking, and overall in a measure of fluid ability relative to the control participants. Another part of the rationale behind this program is that sociologists have argued for a long time that we've created an age-segregated society where the roles that we're allowed to have are very tightly tied to our age. So when we're young, we're expected to be involved in education, and when we're older, we're expected to be involved in work, and when we're a little bit older than that, there's not much of a role tied to retirement. Sociologists say that's a status without a role, and it's changing as we have more older people in the world, as the shift in the demographics goes toward older people, but it's not really done. We're not really very age integrated yet, and so part of the rationale for the way we've constructed Odyssey, building it on an existing program that's widely available, is that if this works, we're going to have turnkey science. We're going to have something you can just take off the shelf and use. We've got older adults who can just pay. There can be groups of older adults or community organizations that pay the $130 a year fee and register a whole group of older adults to participate in this. So it's a readily available program that anybody can use. And so even though it's a little messy in terms of science, it's not as neat as some of the training work, is if it has benefits, it'll be widely available, and it'll help us move toward a more age-integrated social structure.